Do you ever find yourself going into information overload? You get so stuck, you can't figure out how to write a joke? That's what we're going to be covering here today on this episode of Ask the Joke Doctor. Hi, Jerry Corley here, aka The Joke Doctor, standupcomedyclinic.com, with another episode of Ask The Joke Doctor. In this episode, we're going to be talking to somebody in Mumbai. That's right, Mumbai, who communicated with me via Facebook Messenger. Normally, I don't really work with Facebook in the Messenger situation, just because Facebook seems to be such a time suck, man. You get on there and the next thing you know, 90 minutes has gone out of your day. So that's why I usually go with Twitter. But in this case, I saw this guy, he reached out and looked like he needed help with the joke. So this is what happened. I'm gonna walk you through sort of the real-time scenario of me talking to this cat in Mumbai via Facebook Messenger. It's really kind of cool how comedy is blowing up all over the world. You know, I was just in a conversation recently with a guy from Botswana. So that was really awesome. And he shared with me photos of the open mic they do or the mics they do there in Botswana in Africa, man. That's like, so comedy's like everywhere now. It used to just sort of be stuck with the United States, Canada, the UK, Australia, and pretty much that's it. All over the world, stuff is blowing up, so this is kind of cool, right? This guy's name is Krishna Pandey. Sir, I have completed your book, Breaking Comedy's DNA, 2 months ago. It's a very helpful book, but now I have coming some problem. I can't write a joke. I tried a lot, but how to write jokes about one topic, and I'm overanalyzing my jokes now. Yep, that can happen. Look, Breaking Comedy's DNA deals with the science and the structure of comedy. So there's a ton of information in that book that basically breaks down why the human beings laugh, number one, and then how to apply structures to make them laugh. So at the beginning, when you burn through that book, it can leave you with information overload, just like any subject matter. When you're mostly using your right brain to create, you know, that's the emotional side, sort of the free-flowing side, that's the side of the brain that captures images and the familiar. And then you start getting into the analysis or the analytical side of the comedy, the structures, the laughter triggers. Sometimes you get into information overload. That happens with anybody who's studying music theory or studying the sort of the color wheel. It's like you feel like you're locked out of the free-flowing creativity for a moment, but don't worry. That's why you have two hemispheres of the brain and they're separated by a corpus callosum. So it shares information yet filters it so that you can work freely with that right side of the brain, which is the expressive self. And then you can work as well with the analytical side and write from your mechanics. And I'm gonna show you how right here. So here's what happened. So he's kind of overthinking. I think we've all done this, right? You're trying to figure out a joke and it just won't come to you. You feel like you're just like, your mind is it's sometimes getting a headache. So here's what we did. I said, hi Krishna, that's not unusual. It's probably information overload. Send me a few of the jokes you're working on and I'll try to help. So he goes, sir, I wrote most of my jokes in Hindi, but some of them are in English. For example, he writes, interviewer, where do you see yourself after 5 years? Me. This question should be asked only from astrologers. First of all, it didn't make any sense to me because I was like, the astrologer would know where you see yourself in 5 years. You would ask him, where do you see me in 5 years? So that, for example, didn't make any sense, right? So the astrologer is the one who sees the future based on your stars. So he would know where you are. So I said, I wrote in the first joke, is the interviewer interviewing you for a job? Specifics are important. So he says, yes, he's interviewing me for a job. I say, what kind of job? And he says, customer care executive. I'm drilling down to the specifics. We can stay very vague, but usually when the audience can see the pictures, smell the smells, feel the textures, they're in the story with you more readily. They can see those visuals too, and so therefore they're compelled in your story. So he said, what kind of, I said, customer care executive. I said, what kind of company? And I said, we're looking for association possibilities. And he said, credit cards. Again, he's rolling vague the entire time, like he's like being he's being interrogated by the cops, and he doesn't want to, he only wants to give up exactly the information he has to give up. But let's drill down to the specifics. Let's get colorful. So I said, Visa, MasterCard, American Express? And he said, Visa. Aha! Now that opens up the world of opportunities, doesn't it? So once he says that credit card Visa, we know Visa. We're familiar with that brand. We see that picture. We see the Visa logo, right? All of that stuff happens. Like if I say Home Depot, you see Home Depot. Bill Burr does a joke, and the joke is sort of like this. He talks about Arnold Schwarzenegger. He says, you say to Arnold Schwarzenegger, you can't be a great man, really? He says, how many of you could move to Austria, learn the language, become famous for lifting weights, marry into their royalty, run for public office and win? How many lifetimes would it take? I'm on my third attempt at Rosetta Stone Spanish. Now with that joke, how many of you got that immediate image of the yellow box with the black font when he said Rosetta Stone Spanish? Why didn't he say online Spanish course or learning Spanish? He said Rosetta Stone Spanish because that imagery really pops. And that's what triggers the laugh, is that imagery, that recognition. So when he said Visa, I already have a joke, right? So it just popped into my mind. I said, so Visa's slogan is everywhere you want it to be. Is that the same in Mumbai? And he said, yes, sir. Aha. So if the slogan is the same in Mumbai, then the audience in Mumbai would get the joke that I'm about to lay out. Now, I say the joke. I said, so with that information, you might say the joke like, I was interviewed for a job at Visa as a customer care executive. Or I might share, so I was interviewed for a job at Visa as a customer care executive. And I might pretend to share a secret with the audience and go, complaint department. So the Visa interviewer said, where do you see yourself in 5 years? And I said, well, Visa might be everywhere you want it to be, but I'll probably still be stuck in this cubicle. So that's the joke, right? So it's using a compare and contrast. So the lesson to be learned here is the funny is in the specifics. So don't be vague, get specific. You can always pull back later if some of that stuff is not necessary, but if we can see those images, it's gonna help us a lot more. Also, we gotta remember the five elements of story when you're telling the story. If we don't know the setting, if we can't see where you are, it's gonna hinder our ability to be able to communicate this story to an audience and help them to be able to see it. So five elements of story are character, theme, setting, plot, conflict. I would also argue that narrative arc should be in there, but that's a different story. So we wanna see we wanna know the character. Like if I'm talking about my daughter, and I don't mention her name, her age, it's gonna be hard for you to get the picture of where she is in the scenario, where she is standing next to me. Is she five? Is she eight? Is she 20? So we need to know the character. Character, they see you up there, but if you're telling the story about somebody else, we gotta be able to see that person. So the specifics are important. Theme, we're talking about job interview. Setting, in an office somewhere at Visa. And getting specific, Visa. So the plot is I'm being interviewed for a job at Visa, and the conflict, getting asked the question, and how am I gonna answer this question? Because when an interviewer asks you the question for a job interview, you really kind of feel the pressure to answer it correctly so that you'll have a better opportunity of getting a job at that company. So Visa might be everywhere you want it to be, but I'll probably be stuck right here in this cubicle. So that's the joke. So that's kind of how we went through that through that system right there on Facebook Messenger. And remember, where you can always check back with the joke and say, okay, does it have the elements necessary? We know recognition is a laughter trigger. So that was there, Visa. Coincidence, what a coincidence that you were able to inject this familiar, recognizable Visa slogan into a job interview with being interviewed by a guy from Visa and turn it back on him. That's a little bit of benign retaliation, some incongruity, job interview, Visa, everywhere you want it to be, and I'll be stuck here in this cubicle. And then compare and contrast. Compare and contrast is a structure that always works, seems to work in comedy if it's done right. I also call it complex to simple. For example, compare and contrast could be I had to break up with my girlfriend. We just weren't compatible. You see, I'm a Leo and she is a bitch. So that's complex to simple. Now, I probably wouldn't use that joke anymore today because, you know, women's empowerment and hashtag you too, me too, and that would be me too, you too. So I don't want to get involved. I try to avoid calling women names for without any reason or recourse. If I set her up as an antagonist, I might get away with that as a joke, but I usually avoid those names now. And it's a good bet for most everybody. So once we have the recognizable brand, we can draw an association with a common realm of knowledge, and the association makes the joke work, right? So there you go, real-time joke writing with the joke doctor. That's kind of why they gave me the name the joke doctor. You go, wow, you can fix jokes. But once you understand the structures and the laughter triggers, it starts to all sort of make sense, and you start to almost like put it together like it's automatic because you practice so much and you write so much. So I hope this brought value to your day. And Krishna, I hope you enjoyed that. And thank you for letting me use this as an example. I did ask your permission. So if you want to ask me any questions, head on over to Twitter and go ahead and follow me at Joke Doctor, and then ask the question and use the hashtag, if you have room, hashtag Ask the Joke Doctor, and I'll be happy to put a video together like this just for you. And if you do like these videos, please feel free and hit that subscribe button. And there's a little bell icon now you'll see over to the right of that. And that you click that and it'll start to send you reminders or notifications when I upload new videos. Take care. Hope you enjoyed this little video. Talk to you very soon. Bye-bye.